some of my old buddies or acquaintances might be viewing this and thinking, you know, is that the same guy I knew? It's not. I'm no pastor. I mean, I don't live a perfect life. I fall just like I did before, but now I'm forgiven. I get back up. I learn from it, and I go on, and I just keep getting closer and closer. The more time goes on, the closer I get to Jesus, the more I want to read the Bible, and it just keeps building and building. There's a lot of Bible to read, and you can just read and reread a certain verse, and you'll get something new out of it every time. I read Ephesians quite often. I like that book. It says, there's another one that just about made, in fact it did. I read that verse, it's in Matthew. I read it shortly after I was saved, because I started out in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and I was going on from then. And in Matthew 11:20, it just broke me down, because that's where I was. It says, Matthew 11:28, it says, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened," and that's what I was. I was weary and burdened, "and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. I will find, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." And I read that, and it's exactly, it happened before I read it, and it just hit me right between the eyes. And there's a lot of verses in Scripture that he shows true right before your eyes. But you got to read it to get these blessings. All I can say is, by this, if you, like I said before, if you turn from the way that you're living, if you really want to get out of this trap, the world is really a terrible place to live. It's tough. The king of the earth is not Jesus. And he'll do everything he can to try to keep you from feeling the way I'm feeling right now. He did it to me for 20 years, thinking, or almost 30 years, thinking I was good enough. I had an upbringing in the church. I'll go to heaven. But that was wrong. You got to get into the Word and listen to it and do it. Apply it to your life, and you're going to get out of the problems you're in. As sure as I'm standing here, he'll do it for you. He did it for me. That's the reason I come here today, was to give glory to God, and this is my Christmas present to him. And he got me through it. I was really nervous about this, and I had no problems. Praise the Lord. I asked him to give me strength and get through it, and I've had no problem. And I'm glad that I did it, and I just want to tell you that to try it, to get into the Word of the passages I just told you, and he'll do it for you. And that's what I wanted to say. And my wife is here, and she's going to share with you too in a few minutes. So we'll be looking forward to that. Thank you.
I was raised in a Christian home and attended Christian school and went to a Christian church. I believe the Bible to be the infallible Word, that is, the absolute truth, the Word of God. I believe Jesus was the Son of God who came to save us from our sins by his birth, death, and resurrection. I accepted him as my Savior at an early age, and I assumed I was okay since I had believed and asked him to be my Savior. I remember doing this a few times as I seemed to still be muddling through. I failed to know the Bible. It was God's truth as only a reference book to me. I didn't spend much time getting to know what it said. If only I'd read and taken to heart verses like Romans 10, verse 9 through 11. This says that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. As the scriptures say, anyone who trusts in him will never be put to shame. You may be thinking that is exactly what I had done. No, I'd only asked him to be my Savior. I never allowed him to be Lord in my life. I'd only taken the forgiveness and not the rest. I spent many more years empty and hurting deep inside, never quite understanding how to get what I knew in my head down into my heart. I sunk into behaviors I knew deep within were wrong, but I rationalized them. These are some of the rationalizations I used. As God would understand, he knows that I've been hurt. Or God will understand, he knows this world is full of sin. And it's the 80s. He couldn't expect me to live a perfect life. besides I'm only dabbling into this a little, look at it, at all who are much worse than me. I found myself lowering my standards and values little by little. I was thinking and didn't even know it. I just rationalized more. I'd been married 7 years and had 2 children. A few years into the marriage, I submitted to an amputation of my lower leg. It was grossly deformed, caused by a birth defect, which over the years had spread and become at times painfully unbearable. I drew closer to God at this time, felt his comfort and strength. I received a verse which I leaned on through the affliction and through the difficult time of the surgery and recovery. It was Isaiah 41, verse 9 and 10, and I'll read that. It says, I have chosen you and have not rejected you, so do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. As I recovered, my marriage began to fall apart. I attended church on and off through that time with my children. I didn't know how to apply God's truth to troubles, how to give control over to Jesus. I was trying to fix it myself, and it was blowing up in my face. The marriage eventually ended up in divorce. I was hurt and vulnerable, bitter and vindictive. I felt condemned and guilty for divorcing my husband, which I now know was Satan's condemnation, which sent me on a downward spiral. Lonely and desperate, I fell into the bar scene, not knowing how else or where else to fill my pain. I used the bar scene as a band-aid for my heartache. Much of the time I spent there, I watched people. Everyone seemed to be a case. They were responding in desperation out of their problems. Funny, I never saw myself as one of them. In their actions, they were hurting themselves and those around them, myself included. Eventually, I sunk to the bottom where my heart was broken, not over someone else, but in the realization of who I'd allowed myself to become, to what pits I'd allowed myself to fall. I wept and wept. I don't remember crying out to God, but now I know he was right there, bringing me slowly out of the pit. I decided at that time I no longer could be used by men. I despised them. At this time, unbeknown to me, I'd already met my future husband, Dennis. We were friends. By God's grace, he had placed Dennis right in my life at just the right time. Eventually, I trusted him enough to date him and to marry. As is typical, we loved each other and only needed each to love and breathe. Our goal was to get somewhere in life and acquire things to go for the gusto. I was pregnant and working and planning to return to work after our child's birth. Everything was as close to wonderful as I thought it could be. That is, until our child was born. A short time after her birth, we were told the bad news. She had a birth defect. Her esophagus did not join her stomach, and she required surgery to correct the situation. Her first day, she had tubes inserted to be fed through, and her third day was when she actually had the corrective surgery. My body, which had cradled our growing child, was now empty, but my arms were empty too. It wasn't until our 8th day that I held her again, and then only for a few minutes at a time. I wanted to be near her, but my other 2 children needed me too. I was torn. Every day as I'd drive back and forth from the hospital, I would ask God, "Why, God, what are you trying to tell me?" What I learned is that I'd forgotten God again, and that God is in control, not me. I saw that our focus had been on ourselves and material things with no room for God until I needed him. As I drawn closer to him in the crisis, I learned that the little baby which had been in me was more important than any material gain I could have. She was in the neonatal ICU for 28 days in all. As her first month went along, she became increasingly bothered after her feedings. It seemed to bother her breathing. Throughout the month, I received several different medical reasons, never a clear explanation that felt right. Then it happened.